Hello, everyone. Welcome to the webinar on NIGMS Predoctoral T32 training programs. My name is Shiva Singh. I'm the chief of the Predoctoral training branch at NIGMS. Let me begin with today's webinar agenda. After the introductions, we'll have our institute director, Dr. John Loris, give his opening remarks. That will be followed by Dr. Allison Gammy. Allison is the director of the Division of Training, Workforce Development, and Diversity. She'll give an overview of the NIGMS-sponsored predoctoral T32 training programs, a bit about the application process, and what are our expectations from the NIGMS-funded training programs. After Allison, we'll have Dr. Stephanie Constant talk about the review aspects of the training programs, what we have observed from the last two rounds of reviews of new T32 applications. Stephanie is the chief of the Office of the Scientific Review at NIGMS. And finally, we'll have question and answer period. So talking about the question and answer, we'd like you to type in the questions in the chat box that should appear on your screen, and at the end of the presentations, we'll try to answer them. We'll have, by the way, the slides from the webinar as well as the videos. We'll post them on our website, the training program website, so just in case you want to refer to them later on, you should be able to do that. Finally, I'd like to have this disclaimer that what we say here, what we share with you, is really only part of the requirements that you need to know about. I strongly encourage you to read the entire FOA and the relevant guide notices to get a bigger picture, to get a fuller picture of what you need to do to put in a competitive application. Before I hand it over to Dr. Loris, let me also welcome our NIGMS staff. Several of the T32 training program directors have joined us. So have the review, IT, grants management staff, and our support staff. So welcome, everybody. And with that, Dr. Loris.
Thanks, Shiva. Thanks, everyone, for joining us. We thought that as the new FOAs and the effort to catalyze modernization of graduate education through NIGMS's programs had been underway for some months now, it would be good to touch base with the community to find out what questions you have and to emphasize some things that maybe we felt needed re-emphasis. And to give you some lessons that we've learned so far from the peer review and application processes. Hopefully you're all very familiar with the fact that for some years we've been working on these efforts to catalyze the modernization of graduate education. NIGMS is in a unique position to do that, given that almost half of all NIH-funded graduate student T32 slots are coming from just this one institute, NIGMS. And so I think it's really incumbent on us to make sure that they are being used as effectively and efficiently as possible, and hence this major effort to reform graduate education across the country. A few of the themes you're going to be hearing about, and hopefully you're already familiar with, are an emphasis on skills building during the didactic portion of the graduate training that NIGMS is supporting and that your institutions are conducting, an emphasis on building diversity. I think it's something that you also hopefully are well aware of something that we are focusing on quite a bit. And you'll hear about through the course of discussions here a number of other areas that we're hoping that you will increasingly emphasize and find better ways to do, such as an emphasis on career development and a variety of different career paths. Couple of things I think I just want to emphasize at the beginning to kind of get things off with a bang, maybe. One is in terms of the skills building part of this new emphasis that we have, we are hoping and expecting that you are not just going to be adding on new components of a curricula or other kinds of activities onto an already packed agenda for students, but you will instead be really rethinking how you are educating and training the students from the ground up. Obviously, with the first round or so of new applications, we weren't expecting quite as high a bar for these kinds of new efforts. We understand there's going to be a ramp-up period and people have to get used to what's happening. But as we move along here, really starting perhaps now, I think we're going to be expecting to see some major curriculum reform efforts going on across the country. So if you are coming in the next few rounds for either a new application or an application, they're all new applications, but an application for a new version of your T32 for an existing program, we would expect, I think, to be seeing some pretty significant curriculum reform efforts, either at least in the planning stages, if not underway. And if we're not seeing that, I think we're going to be worried. And so if you're not thinking about that, I would strongly urge you to start thinking about that. I know it's a very difficult, time-consuming process. I've been through it myself, but it really is what we're expecting to see. In a similar vein, we also expect that the programs, the T32 programs, are supporting and are integrally connected to the graduate program itself. We really don't want to see the T32 being something that's just layered on top of an existing graduate structure, and it's just being used to support the graduate students in the labs. This really should be, the T32s really should be integral to the training environment and should be the framework around which your graduate program is built. So I hope you think about that as well as we move along here. So thank
Great.
You.
Wonderful. Thanks, John. So I'm Allison Gammy, the Director of Training, Workforce Development, and Diversity, and I'm just going to walk through some slides to give you a sense of what we're looking for in these training programs and also hope to help you with the application process. So to reiterate what John was saying, today we're going to be talking about our basic biomedical graduate programs as well as the medical science training program. And all of our training programs share common themes. And what we're trying to do is what John just said, is to encourage changes in biomedical graduate training that will keep pace with the rapid evolution of the research enterprise. And as you know, it's increasingly complex, interdisciplinary, and collaborative. What we want to see is that you provide high-quality research training, mentored research experiences, and additional opportunities that will equip trainees with the technical, operational, and professional skills that are required to transition into the biomedical research workforce. And as John mentioned, and I'm just going to reiterate, the intention is not to layer additional activities onto existing structures, but to really encourage creative approaches to biomedical graduate education. To address the major themes, just the kind of major takeaways today, as we've already said several times, training skill development, we want to see evidence-based approaches to provide the technical, operational, and professional skills needed. We want to see specific aims, similar to a research grant where you have your goals and objectives for a five-year period. We want to see that you have educational, specific, and measurable goals. Additionally, an important part and a big change is to emphasize rigor and transparency, as well as the responsible and safe conduct of research. And we don't want to see this just as a couple of one-offs, but it's threaded throughout the entire training period from beginning until the individuals earn their PhDs. As John mentioned, we have a strong commitment to diversity and inclusion. We believe that excellence in training requires a diverse group of people coming to the enterprise, and we hope that to see activities in this area. We also want to see a strong commitment to mentor training and oversight of the mentor-mentee match throughout the period. As John mentioned, career preparedness, so making sure that the trainees have the skills that they need to transition into the next phase, but also an understanding of the careers that are out there so that they can plan and develop their own individualized skill set to transition to the next step. A new component and a big difference is that we really expect to see a strong institutional commitment to the program, to the training program, and we'll get to it in a minute, how this is expressed, but this is a really important part of programs going forward. And finally, another area that we want to see is the evaluation. So is it working? Is the training program working? This involves the collection and dissemination of data on successful and successes as well as failures of your educational aims. And then we'd like to see outcomes posted publicly, particularly for career outcomes, so that trainees know the range of careers that individuals before them have transitioned into. So the program objectives have really flipped to be, instead of being about the program and their activities, it's about the individuals, the trainees, and what kinds of skills they have, and are they able to transition into careers in the biomedical research workforce. So the basic biomedical, the language is shown here. The MSTP is similar, very similar language, except that it's obviously for trained physician scientists, not just scientists. And also we have an emphasis on transitioning into careers that utilize a dual degree, and that these individuals will become leaders in advancing the research to meet the needs of the nation. Specifically, what do we mean by technical and operational professional skills? You can see them as they're at the bottom of all of these slides, but in particular, we hope to see individuals that have a broad understanding across biomedical disciplines and the skills to independently acquire the knowledge needed to advance their chosen field. The ability to think critically and independently and to identify important biomedical research questions and approaches that push forward the boundaries of their area of study. And continuing with technical and operational skills, a strong foundation in rigorous research design, experimental methods, quantitative literacy and reasoning skills, as well as data analysis and interpretation. We also want to see that they have had experience initiating, conducting, interpreting, and presenting rigorous and reproducible biomedical research with increasing self-direction. In terms of moving into professional skills, that these individuals have the ability to work effectively in teams with colleagues from diverse cultural and disciplinary backgrounds, and to promote inclusive, safe, efficient, productive, and supportive scientific research environments. We also would like to see the individuals that have the skills and opportunities to communicate scientific research methodology and findings to a wide variety of audiences, and this includes discipline-specific audiences across disciplines and to the general public. And also to have the knowledge, professional skills, and experience required to identify and transition into productive careers in the biomedical research workforce. But the same is true for the MSTP program, but there are a few additional caveats. Instead of just being about scientists, there's also an emphasis on clinical skills as well for all of the above. Also, the skills necessary to integrate research and clinical activities in support of a productive research career that combines both qualifications, clinical and research. And the ability to utilize clinical experiences and observations to inform research projects and to use research findings to inform clinical practice. All right, so that's sort of giving you the main themes, the broad themes, some of the changes for what was on the previous parent announcements, and now we'd want to drill a little bit down to see whether or not your particular program is a good fit with NIGMS. And while we are a very broad area, we represent broad areas of sciences, there are some limits within this, and it's important to ensure that it's a good fit with NIGMS. So NIGMS has several areas. Your training program really needs to fit within one of these areas. They're listed here and on our web page as well. For those of you familiar with our previous programs, these have not changed, except that we've added one new category, and that's a transdisciplinary category. And what that can be, one of two things: that if you are an institution that's never had one of our NIGMS predoctoral T32 programs, you would be eligible for this category. Also, another group is if you're merging two existing programs that have been at a single institution, you're eligible for this category as well. And so every institution is allowed to have one program in each of these areas. And this is normally defined by what's called a DUNS number or an institutional profile number. All right, so once you've decided that you're a good fit, I should say, I'm going to say it now and I'll say it several times. First, you should really consult with program staff to make sure that you really are a good scientific fit. You don't want to go through the application process to find that it really is not a good fit. So first and foremost, contact program staff here and we'll make sure that it's a good fit. Once you've made that decision, you can start moving towards the application process. I'm listing here, I won't reel them off, but the specific web pages for the two different FOAs, the basic biomedical, the MSPP FOA. We're also showing you web pages that have general information, frequently asked questions, and importantly, the last one there, that's the NIGMS program staff who will be able to help you navigate this process. All right, starting out with the application, there are many components. You can see that the program plan is the largest component. We encourage you and strongly urge you to adhere to the page limits. Your application will not be accepted if you exceed these pages. But you can also see that there's quite a bit of space to fully explain your training program. All right, now I'm going to move into probably the main text of the application, and that includes the program plan. As I mentioned, we want to see that there's a rationale, that you have a training mission, that you have specific objectives, and as well an overall training plan that's designed to meet these mission and objectives. So the objectives should be specific and measurable, so you really want them to be obtainable within a five-year period, and that you have metrics that will be strong indicators of success. As I mentioned, we want to see the rationale for the training program. You must describe distinctions and synergies with other NIH or NIGMS-funded T32 programs. What is this particular program offering that's distinct, but how will you work with and synergize with other programs? We've mentioned several times we want to have an emphasis on skill development and importantly, meeting the objectives of the training program. So what skills are going to the trainees have obtained that are in alignment with a specific objective. We want to strongly encourage the use of evidence-based approaches to training and mentoring. There's a lot of literature about what kinds of approaches are effective in terms of strong educational outcomes, and we really want to see the use of these kinds of methods in the graduate space. To illustrate an example of a training pathway from the time the student enters until they obtain the PhD, we want to see representative examples of the training pathway. Explanations of how differences in backgrounds of the individuals entering the programs will be accommodated and supported. This is an important point. We want to see enhancements to the training environment, and this goes beyond just the few or individually supported trainees. It really has a broader effect on the training environment. And I do want to mention that sometimes people get confused between having a distinct program and then also wanting to have synergies or have a broader effect. I think the distinction part is what is distinct about this training program, but enhancements to training environment can have much broader some of the skills-based effects. So it's important to navigate these both of these points. If you have a multidisciplinary program, you need to describe in detail how the training program integrates across the various departments, and as John was mentioning, it doesn't just layer requirements on top, but really you have efficiencies and synergies with the various requirements across the department. We have a strong emphasis on career development, and that includes the range of careers in the biomedical research workforce. MSTP, we put an emphasis on research residencies as an outcome of training programs. But we do want to emphasize that there's a range of careers that support the biomedical research workforce and that those should all be taken into mind when training individuals. We want to see that the students are provided with opportunities to develop the skills that are needed and also opportunities potentially for experiential learning, such as internships, shadowing, or informational interviews. And as I mentioned previously, to have transparency about outcomes of individuals so that when trainers are making decisions about programs, they understand where they're headed in terms of their career outcomes. An important component of all programs is that we want to see that there is programmatic oversight. We want to ensure that trainees are in research environments when they transition into the laboratories, for example, that promote the responsible conduct of research as well as these laboratories are conducting rigorous and reproducible research. We want to see oversight of the individuals throughout the training process, not just the time they're supported by the grant, but across the entire pathway. We also want to see that the faculty who have been selected is a very thoughtful process and that the group of people who are brought together are committed to training and mentoring, and that you provide these individuals with mentor training opportunities. Again, in terms of oversight, ensuring that the participating faculty will interact with their mentees in terms of career advising, including but not limited to the use of individual development plans or IDPs. And also, we'd like to see mechanisms for a thoughtful matching of mentors and mentees, as well as monitoring of this mentor-mentee relationship. In particular, we want to see that there are plans for removing faculty who show poor mentorship qualities from the program. And as I said before, we really want to see a group of faculty who are committed to training the next generation of scientists. As I mentioned, a new, somewhat expensive component of the new programs is to see a strong institutional commitment to research training. So we want to see that they value and promote rigor and responsible conduct of research, that there are mechanisms in place to ensure the continuity of training, for example, startup funds to faculty or bridging funds so that there's continuity of training, that they provide resources and research infrastructure to individuals, that they provide support to the PIs of the grant, training staff, as well as the participating faculty, and this can look take many manifestations, including financial support or protected time. We want to see that the institution is committed to teaching and mentoring. Some examples of this could include having that as part of a tenure and promotion process. Emphasizing what we said before, that there's support for remediation or removal from the training program poorly performing mentors. We want to see, of course, diversity and inclusion is supported at all levels of the research training environment, and this ranges from trainees, staff, faculty, as well as institutional leaders. Ensure that the research and with the MSCP, as well as clinical facilities and the laboratories and clinical practices, all promote the safety of the trainees. This is a really important to us. There have been some high-profile cases of accidents, and the safety of the individuals is very important. Ensure that the research and when relevant, clinical facilities are accessible to trainees with disabilities, that the institution promotes positive, supportive, and inclusive research and clinical training environments for individuals from all backgrounds. We also want to see that the institution has policies and procedures in place to prevent and respond to discriminatory harassment and other discriminatory practices. We want to ensure that trainees will continue to be supported when they transition from the training grants to other sources, and that the institution provides resources and expertise for evaluating the training outcomes of the program. And then, importantly, we want to see that the institution with multiple T32 training programs explains how they're distinct from but synergized with certain activities and really so to increase efficiency, but this has to come from the institutional level, that there is an understanding that there's not overlap programs. So if multiple institutions are participating, as we do in some of our programs, there has to be plans for recruitment of trainees and faculty and integration of programs across the institution. So this should be included in a single document. It's called the Institutional Letter of Support, and it has a 10-page limit, and it's a standalone attachment that we look for in the letters of support. All right, so moving along through I just asked people to mute if they could. Thank you. So in terms of the program directors and principal investigators, obviously it's important to have at least one of the individuals who has scientific expertise in the area that you're proposing. They should also have administrative and training experience. We want to see that the individuals have sufficient bandwidth to oversee the program, that they themselves or multiple people have a record of using rigorous and transparent methods in experimental design, data collection, analysis, and reporting, that there's a demonstrated commitment to training the next generation of biomedical researchers, and that they have received training to mentor individuals from a diversity of backgrounds. We actually encourage a multi-PI approach, in particular to bring complementary expertise to the enterprise. So you can have a person with the scientific background, you might want an institutional leader, potentially a person who has experience with evidence-based practices in education, so social scientists. We'd like to see multi levels of expertise brought together in a multi-PI team. In terms of the faculty or the preceptors mentors, also known as program faculty, we want to see that the program is thinking about creating a diverse team. And this includes individuals from underrepresented backgrounds, women, and faculty at different career stages. In particular, look for individuals who display a commitment to training, have the appropriate expertise, resources, and bandwidth, importantly, to provide research training, that they will provide opportunities to initiate, conduct, interpret, and present rigorous reproducible research with increasing self-direction, that they will promote the development of trainees in approaches to rigorous experimental design, methods of data collection, and data analysis. And they're committed to effective mentoring and promoting inclusive, safe, and supportive research environments. In terms of the trainee positions, recruitment, and retention, it's extremely important to provide a strong justification for the number of requested positions. And this is placed in the context of the training grant eligible pool, as well as the available faculty to support the research training area. We also want to see that active efforts are being made to recruit individuals from diverse backgrounds. We also want to see implementation of holistic approaches to admissions, so going beyond the grade point average or standardized test scores to look holistically at the application process to ensure that there are no cutoffs or barriers to admissions. Oh, we're out of order here, sorry. We want to see that expanding upon, there's a separate place for a trainee retention plan to make sure that you're thinking about the range of students in the program and how you can ensure their persistence in the program. Also, as I mentioned, provide the rationale for the training appointments. NIGMS really encourages appointment early in graduate training, for example, in years 1 through 3. So you need to provide a strong rationale for when they'll be appointed, how many, and so on. So training outcomes are extremely important, and it's understood that these are all new applications. However, you should provide outcomes of trainees that either came from a similar program in the past, or if you're starting a new program and drawing from different areas, just examples of the previous successes. So what we'd like to see is that that the trainees, there was evidence that they advanced scientific knowledge and or techniques, and they did this with increasing self-direction. An indicator of this is often whether the trainees have first author publications. We want to see completion in time to degree, and importantly, to compare individuals from underrepresented groups with those from well-represented groups. you're able to outline the success of graduates transitioning into careers in the biomedical research workforce, and there's a training table, Table 8A, Part 3, specifically to do this. Because you're new applications, you're only able to provide 5 years in that data table. However, if you want to provide more details up to 15 years, you can do so in the narrative. For the MSTP, the outcomes, we want to see outcomes for individuals participating in research-based residencies. And in terms of long-term outcomes, are they physician scientist leaders? Or have they transitioned into careers where they're using the dual degree? And I think I should say this for outcomes in general, so past success does not guarantee that the current program is effective, so you have to have a combination of past success and that you have a robust and excellent training program that's put forth in the application. In terms of program evaluation, we want to see an assessment process to determine whether the overall program is effective in meeting the goals and objectives. And again, each program, you have stated your own goals and objectives. Whether the scientific research climate is inclusive, safe, and supportive of trainee development. What the plans are or the current practices for being responsive to internal or external outcomes, analyses, critiques, surveys, and evaluations. And obviously it goes without saying that there needs to be robust structures in place to track trainee career outcomes and make the data publicly available. So another component of the application that's a standalone component is the plan for instruction in the responsible conduct of research. I think many of you should be familiar with this at this point. You also need to, for these funding announcements, explain how the components are well integrated into the overall curriculum at multiple stages within training development. Explain how the RCR training synergizes with a curriculum that's designed to enhance trainees' ability to conduct rigorous and responsible research. And describe how program faculty reiterate and augment key elements of the curriculum when trainees are performing research in their own labs. Sorry, I should go back. A couple of resources for RCR policy and resources are shown there. Here's a new component for those of you who have been in the system a while. We really want to see a separate plan for the instruction of methods for enhancing reproducibility. And basically, you want to describe how the trainees will be instructed in principles important for enhancing research reproducibility, including the evaluation of foundational research underlying the project, rigorous experimental design and data interpretation, considering relevant biological variables, authentication of key biological or chemical resources, data material, sharing, record keeping, and transparency in reporting. As before, you want to make sure that these instructions are well integrated throughout the curriculum, how they're taught at multiple stages of the trainee development in a variety of formats and contexts. And again, you want to make sure that the faculty are reiterating and augmenting these key elements of methods for enhancing reproducibility when the trainees are in their individual research labs. So we have resources, again, for rigor and reproducibility. We have the general NIH site. We also at NITMS have supported our 25 grants to provide training modules in this area, as well as a variety of NIGMS administrative supplements. So you can go to these pages to see how your peers have addressed this issue. We also are looking for something different with the faculty bio sketches. We expect to see a personal statement that will address training, mentoring, and promoting inclusive, safe, and supportive research environments. That they have a record of providing training in rigorous and unbiased experimental design, methodology, analysis, interpretation, and reporting of results. That they support trainees in participating in activities required to identify and transition into careers in the biomedical research workforce. And that there is a track record of fulfilling the need of the trainees to complete their PhDs in a timely fashion with the skills, credentials, and experiences to transition into the workforce. All right, so there are a few other required components we mentioned already. In the letters of support section, there's a mandatory institutional letter with a 10-page limit. As always, there are data tables that are required listed here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5A, 6A, 8A, Part 2. One of the things I can't emphasize enough is check that they are internally consistent within the individual application and that the tables match the narrative. Make sure that they're complete and accurate, and this is the reviewer, Stephanie will get to this, but the reviewers really scrutinize these tables, and please take care. There's some resources shown below on the slide here that you can turn to get help with these data tables. We have some attachments in one case that are either allowed or required. So if you are to have an advisory committee, which is optional, there's a place to put an attachment. There are two required attachments. One is the recruitment plan to enhance diversity. And then there's a new one that for those of you who are coming in, that is about trainee retention. And this should be about retention of all trainees within the program. So in terms of the recruitment plan to enhance diversity, at the bottom you see a web page. We have detailed effective practices that your peers are using to recruit individuals from underrepresented groups. You should describe these outreach strategies. If you need a reminder of the groups we're talking about, the notice is shown. You have a hyperlink here, the NIH's interest in diversity. You should describe the efforts to be undertaken specifically by the training program and how it involves training program faculty. You should know that centralized institutional requirements alone don't fulfill this effort. And then knowing also that just providing accommodations for persons with disabilities doesn't count as outreach or recruitment. In terms of the trainee retention plan, you should describe the efforts to sustain the scientific interest of trainees from all backgrounds. Describe the specific efforts that are to be undertaken by training program, including the involvement of training faculty. And as before, centralized institutional efforts alone will not meet this requirement. In addition, we have I'm going to break it out into two parts. So for the basic biomedical T32, we have a required attachment for the responsible conduct of research syllabus. We have allowable appendices, including courses, electives, and training activities, up to a total of 4, evaluation and assessment instruments, trainee appointment procedures, and conflict resolution protocols. For the medical science training program, we wrote this one afterwards and realized it was really probably important to that the reviewers have an opportunity to see all the required training activities, so that is a requirement, as is the responsible conduct of research syllabi and trainee appointment procedures. As before, there are some allowables. This includes elective activities, evaluation and assessment instruments, and conflict resolution protocols. I'm just going to say a little bit about the application budget, but I encourage you to use resources available and reach out to us if you need more guidance on this. You're to use the PHS 398 training budget form. The stipends are published annually by NIH, so that's a fixed amount. So for tuition and fees, request total needs. Don't apply any NIH formulas in the budget. That will be done afterwards. Tell what your total needs are. In terms of travel, we provide $300 per trainee. There are also training-related expenses. Again, those are, in that same notice, they're established annually by NIH. This will include health insurance, as long as you're providing health insurance to all similar trainees at the institution. And the indirect costs are 8%. All right, so just some important dates. The next applications are due May 25th, but there's also a September 25th and January 25th deadlines. So as always, it's by 5 p.m. local time. We encourage you to submit early so that any errors can be accommodated and that the applications are submitted. For those coming in May, the peer review will be October to November 2019. The advisory council is in January of 2020, and the earliest start date is July 2020. So with that, I will turn it over to my colleague, Stephanie, and chief of the Office of Scientific Group.
Okay, great. Good afternoon, everyone. As Alvin mentioned, I'm Stephanie Constance. I'm the review chief at NIGMS. And the purpose of my presentation will be to go over how NIGMS reviews T32 applications and also to tell you about some lessons learned from the first two rounds of review and also some of the things that reviewers have struggled with because applicants are maybe not addressing some of the things in an adequate way. And so we're hoping that by telling you some of these things, that will help for your own applications to be more complete. So first, I just want to tell you, for those who are not familiar, we do have two standing committees that review all of our T32 applications, both basic sciences and MSTP. They are TWDA, TWDB, and I've listed the SROs that run these two committees. Each one is made up of 21 members. All of them have a strong expertise in graduate training, and we have a distribution of diversity, gender, and geography as required by federal law. And in cases where we have a very high workload, we may supplement with ad hoc members. So some of the things that we did in preparation for the new T32 followers is that we made a point to expand some of the existing expertise and added some new members that have a strong expertise, specifically in evaluations and outcomes analysis, also career outcomes in graduate education, and people who have experience with training in alternative careers. And the other thing we did is we reduced the initial membership for the committee members to only 2 years, as opposed to initially 4 years. And the reason we did this is because we sort of feel this is still a work in progress to some extent, and by watching how these reviews go and seeing if there's any gaps in expertise that's needed, by having two-year memberships, this enables us to change expertise on a more regular basis as we learn. Of course, membership can be renewed. In fact, it can be up to a total of 6 years. If you're interested in seeing the current membership for the two rosters, I've given you links at the bottom for both A and B rosters. So the other thing we did in preparation for the new FOAs is that we did very extensive orientations with the reviewers. Specifically, we did several webinars that included both program and review staff, and these were held jointly for the members on both the A and B committees to make sure they were getting exactly the same instructions and also to ensure consistency across the review panel. The other thing we did, in particular for the first round of reviews, is that before we even started discussing any applications, the reviewers were reoriented. They were able to ask questions, both from program and review staff, before the review meeting started. And then program and review staff were present throughout in order to clarify anything that seemed to be difficult. We also did a very extensive feedback after the review meeting where we solicited feedback from the reviewers. We gave them an opportunity to tell us some of the things that they still found difficult or maybe that they felt could be better explained in future orientations. And you're going to see some examples of these at the end of my presentation. So some of the slides that I have are really essentially copies of what Allison has already presented, and I'm not going to go over these in detail, but the reason to tell you about these is so that you are aware that anything that's in the instructions for you as applicants, the same instructions are provided to the reviewers. And so it's a way to reassure you that anything that you're being asked to provide, the reviewers are made aware that this is something that they need to look at, and that the review criteria that they're asked use for their evaluation really maps back exactly to the instructions that you've been given. And so we emphasize again the overarching themes of the new T32s. What are the purpose? What is it that NIGMS is looking for? And so this slide here is essentially the same that Allison already presented to you. Just a couple of things we really emphasized to the reviewers, and this is most important for reviewers who had been on the standing committees for a while already, is that we really emphasized to them the importance of forgetting the old review criteria. These are new review criteria with these new FOAs. They have to really adhere to those, and the fact that, as I mentioned, the review criteria match exactly the instructions that you were given as applicants is really a good way for us to be sure that whatever's being evaluated is exactly what you've been asked to provide. Again, we emphasize the importance of looking at these as new training programs. So in other words, the reviewers were instructed very carefully that they need to evaluate what is being proposed as a new program, not what a program previously has, because of course they're going to recognize some of these programs that some of you have had previously, and so they need to evaluate what's in front of them. Although, again, as part of the instructions, you were told that you can talk about a previous program, but this really cannot, it needs to be really in the context of feasibility for your new program. What have you done previously? What worked, didn't work, and how is it that you're going to now design this new program? Also, the importance of justifying the number of slots that the applicants are proposing for their new program. Regardless of what they had previously, you as applicants need to provide a strong justification for what you want for your new program. We also emphasize the importance of holistic approaches to education, that it's not just a research experience anymore for trainees. They need to have a rounded education. We need the reviewers were told to look for evidence of applicants embracing multiple biomedical career paths, and of course the importance of rigor and reproducibility and how it really needs to be integrated throughout the training program. And we also talked about the importance of evaluation. There needs to be evidence that applicants have thought about evaluations and outcomes, and that these not just be long-term outcomes, but also measurable short-term outcomes. So the review criteria are very explicit. At the end of the day, what the reviewers have been asked to really consider when they come to do an overall final impact score is how is this program, how is either the basic science program in this case, going to generate a pool of students that can conduct rigorous and reproducible research and transition into careers in the biomedical research workforce. And regardless of how you go about doing this, this is really the big picture, and this is what's going to drive the final scoring for these applications. In the case of the MSTP, the driving force will be in this case that your program will generate a pool of clinician scientists that can transition into careers in the biomedical research workforce using that degree and become leaders in advancing research to meet the health needs of the nation. So in terms of the actual review criteria themselves, again, I'm not going to go through them in detail, but just to tell you that they do map exactly to the instructions. They are divided up into the same sections that you have been asked to provide, and that's the training program and environment, the program directors, the program faculty, training positions, and training record. And all of these are considered scored review criteria. So each of these sections will receive an individual score, and they will factor in directly to the overall final impact score. There are two other categories that are part of review criteria. The additional review criteria, they don't get an individual score, but they do factor into the final score. And typically, for those of you who are familiar with T32 training programs, this used to really only apply to human subjects, invertebrate animals, and biohazards, which for most training programs didn't really have much to say there. But actually, one of the things that's about to be published, just to give you a heads up, is that we are now including the training methods for enhancing reproducibility plan will now be listed under the additional review criteria. And what that means is because it's a very important component, the importance of rigor and reproducibility, that we felt strongly that it should be factored into the overall impact score. And so we were able to move that section under additional review criteria now, and so it really will have a direct impact on the final scores that reviewers are asked to provide for applications. So as I mentioned, there's a notice coming. It should be published, I believe, in the next couple of weeks or so. And this will, and we will be sure to orient reviewers so they are prepared for that. The final section is the additional review considerations. There's no separate scores for this. And these areas are not considered directly to influence the overall impact score. However, they are being asked to, they do need to be evaluated as acceptable and not acceptable, and that's the recruitment plan to enhance diversity and the training in RCR. And then, of course, the budget and period of support is to do with the number of trainees as well. So I want to just go over a few reminders for when you prepare your application. And the reason I'm doing this is because we at the Office of Scientific Review are the ones that, when we find applications are missing sections or have put in things they shouldn't, we are the ones who have to withdraw these applications. And it's very hard for us, but I think by providing you with a list and a reminder of all these different what needs to be there and not be there, I'm hoping this will help some of you and we won't have to withdraw too many applications the next round. So in each of these slides, you'll see this sort of scary highlighted yellow bit, which is will not be reviewed or will be withdrawn, just as a way of emphasizing that the language is there and I've given you the link of where that language is. And unfortunately, we have to follow that language. So first off, all applications are new. This is for both the basic science and now the MSTP. All of the applications must be new. This means we don't want to see a progress report, which would be typical for renewal applications. Please be sure not to refer to anything about a previous review for any of your previous applications. You know, don't mention how well you did in a previous round of review. That does not mean it's a new application. So again, if your application shows any hint that it's coming in as a renewal, it will be withdrawn. The training data tables, as Allison mentioned, there are required training data tables. I've listed them there again. Please be sure to include all of these tables if any of them are missing, or if you add any that shouldn't be there, any additional tables, your application will be withdrawn and will not be reviewed. Again, Allison mentioned this also, you can include data on previous training programs, additional data that's not in those tables listed there. However, they need to be within the narrative or the text section. Don't include them as a standalone extra table. And they will be considered, you know, feasibility data or preliminary data. If you do want to include any other kinds of tables to do with some other parts of the application, that's fine, but we ask you to please label them something other than table 1, 2, 3, 4. We're suggesting A through Z. The reason for doing this is it makes it easier for the SROs to be able to scan the applications to check what's there and what's not there. So some reminders about other attachments. It's a little bit, for both basic science and the MSTP, there are two required attachments, and that is the recruitment plan to enhance diversity, the trainee retention plan. Both of these are required. If they're missing, your application will not be will be withdrawn and will not be reviewed. You are allowed to have an advisory committee as another attachment. We urge you, however, not to name any individual from that advisory committee. The minute you name anybody and the name is in the application, that actually makes it difficult for us from a conflict perspective, and we may have to not use certain members on the standing committee. Now, the institutional letter of support. Allison went through this in detail. One thing I do want to really emphasize is the importance that all that information must be contained in that one letter. We a couple of rounds ago, the first round of review, we noticed that some applications were coming in where the information was distributed across several letters by different authors. We've since put out a notice to say that that cannot be done. If you have multiple authors, all the information has to be in that letter, and all of them need to sign that one letter. So multiple people can sign one letter, but it all has to be within one letter. And please just remember to include the latest requirement for the oversight of discriminatory practices. So again, this letter is 10 pages maximum. If you go over that 10 pages, or if you include multiple letters to cover all the information, your application will be withdrawn. There has been some confusion about whether you're allowed to have other letters of support beyond that 10-page letter, and the answer is yes. You can have letters from other people, such as collaborators, for example, and there's no page limits to those. Appendix material, it's a little bit different between basic sciences and the MSTP. So for the basic sciences, there is one required element, and that's the RCR syllabus. And then you are allowed several other things, including electives and training activities. Do not submit more than four. And then please, if there's any page limits, please be sure to adhere to those, because again, if anything else is in there, any disallowed materials in the appendices, your application will not be reviewed. The MSTP is a little bit different. It has three different required attachments. Please be sure all three of those are there. There's some other allowable materials. Again, if you don't have those three attached, those three materials, or you have things that shouldn't be there, we will withdraw the application. And so now for the last two slides, I just want to go over some of the things that we've been hearing from reviewers. And I have been sitting in on all the review meetings, so I was there firsthand, hearing what it is that the reviewers are struggling with. So one of the big things that they have been looking for, and that is not always present in some of the applications that have been reviewed, is how rigor and reproducibility needs to be integrated throughout the application. This is a really important new element for these new T32s. So there needs to be evidence that it really is throughout all the different training components. It's not sufficient that it's just in the methods for enhancing reproducibility plan. And as I mentioned, we feel this is such an important component that now it's going to be a scorable component. It's now, as I mentioned, included in the overall impact score. So please be sure to show that you've integrated this throughout the training program. The other thing is the enhancing of diversity. For the most part, applicants have done very well, at least discussing the trainees and how they want to promote and enhance diversity for trainees. But mentors also need to be considered. So please be sure that you talk about how you're going to increase diversity in the faculty within your program. This is a scorable criterion. I mean, it is part of the program plan, so please be sure that you address both of these. And like I said, it's not sufficient to just describe it in a recruitment plan to enhance diversity. And then, you know, if for some reason you've had deficiencies in the past in your program, then say so, but and explain how you're going to address these. One of the things that we sort of sometimes have been seeing is that applicants have been very good at following the instructions and making sure every single little thing is in there, sort of like a checklist. And they seem to forget how to sort of integrate it together and really get across what is special about your program. What is it that's unique about this program compared to other training programs? Yes, you're bringing all these elements together as requested, but how is it really going to be something special for the trainees? And this includes not only comparing your training program within your institution, but also outside. And the use of the word holistic, we did have an application recently where a reviewer mentioned that the word holistic was all the way through the application, but there was no explanation of how, what was holistic and how this approach was holistic. So don't just use the word holistic. Please explain what you mean for your specific program. There was some limitations in some applications for evaluations. They were either very short, like a very short section on evaluations, or they were poorly designed, not well designed. There is sympathy from reviewers that some institutions may not have a lot of resources to carry out very extensive evaluations. And if that's the case, you know, consider reaching out to colleagues, bringing on a collaborator who maybe has more evaluations experience. Take advantage of online resources which are available to explain, you know, how to set up evaluations and outcomes analyses. And, you know, it's important to discuss not just long-term evaluations, but short-term. How are you going to make sure, you know, at the end of every year that you're really on track? Now, the institutional letter, there is a lot in that letter, and I can tell you the reviewers really look at that letter. It may seem like, again, if you put together everything that's required in the letter, that's enough. It really isn't. That letter needs to show that whoever's signing it actually knows what your training program is about, that they actually are not just signing their name at the end of something. I mean, there needs to be a true commitment from this individual to the program. For programs where there's been a PI that had a previous program for a very long, long time, if the same PI coming in with a new program, that's fine. But if you're someone who's been running a program for a long time, you may want to consider a co-director, or at least showing that you're thinking long term, maybe include some transition plans for, you know, down the line. Reviews are really looking at the bio sketch with personal statements. There's been many bio sketches coming in where there's no commitment language included. They really look at every single bio sketch, and they will be looking for that commitment language. And then finally, the importance of justifying the number of slots that you are requesting. We do instruct the reviewers that just because a previous program had 40 slots or whatever, that doesn't mean they can come back and ask for the same number of slots. If you want 40 slots, you've got to explain how you will be able to support those, your training by eligible students, the resources you have. There's a lot of discussion that goes on about the training slots requested. And again, anything that you're trying to request that may not be, you know, our typical NIGMS guidelines for the early years, more than 2 years of funding, it has to be really, really well justified. So I believe that's the last slide, and I think we're ready for questions.
Okay. Thank you,
okay.
John, Alison, and Stephanie. So we'll begin with questions, and to help me do that is Dr. Mercedes Rubio, who is managing the computer that your question should be coming from. Before we get to the questions, Alison mentioned that you should contact the programming staff as you're putting together your application. I cannot overemphasize that aspect. One of the requirements, new requirements, is that you should identify the area for which you are applying putting in your application. So you have to identify whether you sell on molecular biology or molecular biophysics, whatever the area you need to identify that. And to do a good job, make sure your application matches that area. It's really important that you talk with the program officer for that area. Stephanie mentioned support in year one and two. That too, I want to emphasize that's what we like to see. If you are going beyond that, we'll certainly not like to entertain anything beyond year three, but for year three, you should strongly justify if you are going for support of the students in year three. The website, we want to see some real meat in the website. Talk about NIGMS support of training program and not be simply a website about the department or the graduate program in general. So we are looking for training programs to have website that talks about NIGMS support. And our expectations are that's where you're going to post the outcomes. But with that, let's
Jimmy, you're gonna we're gonna post these slides, right? And you also,
yes.
We've also recorded this.
That's
and,
right.
And the actual audio and slides will be
correct. So as John said, as we did last year, we will post the slides, the videos, and like last year, we'll also try to update, to have frequently asked questions. The questions that you're going to ask, if they turn out to be unique, we'll include them as well on our website. So, Dr. Rubio.
Thank you. And I would like to thank everybody who has already submitted questions, and please feel free to continue to do so. One of the first questions we were asked is, which are the new T32 tables that are required? And I put in the chat that is table 1, table 2, table 3, table 4, table 5A, table 6A, table 8A, part 3.
That's good.
Okay. So everybody should have that on your chat. The next question asks, if the applicant will be required to use extract to create the table.
I believe that the requirement for T32 is coming in for fiscal year 2020, so look for that. But I think they put out a notice. We can include the link maybe on the PowerPoint when we post it, just so that you have it. But you can probably find that. That requirement is definitely coming.
Another question is, I would like more information on how to assign multiple affiliations to a trainer, that is a graduate group and a department. Part two of that question, also, if there are any specific training programs for use of extract, that would be helpful.
So,
part one?
Part two, that's the easy one. So the extract is coming up. I don't think it's applicable this round, correct?
No, 2020.
Now, anybody here wants to take the part one of the question?
Will there be training for extract when it becomes a requirement?
Yes, absolutely. And I think we did put a few resources for X-Train extract in the slide, and you should go to those links. There's videos, and then they also have a pretty responsive support team in real time. So you're welcome to use it this time if you want. It's just not a requirement. Yes.
But we're actually working closely with ERA to upgrade extract and X-Train to make it actually more useful for both you and us. So that should be coming soon, too.
Would you like me to repeat part one of that question?
Yeah.
How to assign multiple affiliations to a trainer, that is, the graduate group and a department?
I'm not sure how important it is. Allison Cole, do you want to weigh in?
Well, I think probably in the table where you list the faculty, you can put whatever you want under the departmental affiliation. You could put multiple things in there, I believe.
Yeah.
And their bio sketch, too, can have
right.
multiple lines.
Another question. If there's a new graduate school program that has been in existence for approximately 6 years and only has a few number of graduates thus far, is it okay to use outcomes from individual departments that will be involved in the training?
Yes, I think that's what we actually put in the instructions, and so yes, that's the intention. So either previous graduate programs that similar students. So yes, that's fine.
The next question. I am confused about the MST funding for MST. Generally, we fund the first 2 years of medical school, not graduate school. Can you please clarify?
Sorry, years 1 through 3 of the graduate training, right?
So different programs have different models for funding.
Yeah.
Many programs do fund during the medical school year.
Okay. The next question. Do you recommend that the institutional letter of support from the president
or the vice president to address criteria and then obtain other letters from associate deans?
No, so what we want to see for the institutional letters and all of the bullet points that I listed in the slide, that should be a single 10-page letter from an institutional official, and, you know, it just needs to be a fairly high ranking. We're not going to specify exactly what type of official, but it should be a high ranking official. If there are additional letters of support that don't address those criteria, if there's collaborations with other institutions or other types of letters of support, those can also be included. But they should be separate. But all of the things that we were asking for should be in a single 10-page letter signed by one or many institutional officials.
And where can I get a copy of today's PowerPoint slide?
On our website, hopefully within the next week or so.
I do not understand how to describe an advisory committee without listing the names of the committee's members.
Well, you can talk about what the functions of that committee would be, what they would actually be doing, without really naming anyone, and you can talk about perhaps would they be internal or external members, but don't, as Stephanie said, do not name them.
And also what types of individuals, what types of expertise you want to bring in onto the committee. Fine.
Regarding the faculty mentor's bio sketch, does the evidence for commitment to mentoring and training replace the contributions to science, or does this only go in the personal statement?
So it's the typical bio sketch, and you're allowed to have the scientific publications that are relevant to the training area. So it would be good choosing among the publications of the faculty member to choose the ones that really are most relevant to the training area. It's perfectly fine to mention the scientific area and the rigor with which they conduct their scientific research, because that's part of it. But what we do want to see in the personal statement is not just that they took it straight from their R01 grant and popped it in the training grant. What we want to see is that there's an understanding, first of all, that they're on this training grant, and second of all, that they actually take the time to articulate what their training and mentoring philosophies are and perspectives are. So I think it's actually a kind of combination of scientific approach, rigor, but also training the next generation of scientists.
And that should be in the personal statement.
Right.
Part. So that needs to be rewritten to be for the training grant.
Right.
Mm-hmm. We have a question about letters again. We have another institution that participates in our program. I assume that that should be a separate letter from that institution?
So it should be the same letter, and it can be signed by the officials from both institutions, but one single letter.
I think particularly when it comes to aspects of the research training environment, for example, in the laboratories, but there are some components that are specific to the applicant institution. So, yeah, having them in a combined, having a single letter with multiple signatures would be the way to go.
If your institution holds an award that supports an MSTP, can you also submit a proposal for a T32 that would support dual degree students in another professional school, say veterinary medicine?
No.
No.
So you can have only one MSTP, and that's the only dual degree. Now, you in that program, you could have DVM, and in other words, DVM is allowed now, but you can't have two programs.
No double dipping, folks.
No.
That's the moral of that story. For Table 6A, how would you suggest we account for current MD-PhD students who did not directly enter through the MD-PhD admissions process, but who entered the regular MD program before transitioning into the MD-PhD program in years 2
fourth grade.
So here's the problem. Our table guru is not here. He's somewhere in Europe. And I suggest that you send me an email and I'll forward it to him, or I'll talk to him when he comes back. That's Dr. John Lapan. Unless Lisa, if you are on the phone, you want to weigh in, that's fine. If not, we'll answer any questions on the tables when John comes back. I do want to point out there are two websites on the training tables, a general one and also one on the questions that came up last time. So hopefully your question will be answered, but if looking through those questions and answers, if you still don't see answers to your specific question, please send it to me by email.
Hi, this is Lisa. Basically, you would just list them in, I think it's table, I want to say it's like table eight. You list them and you just say what their first year was, and you can actually just date it. You just would list them the same way. Only it would be that they're the year of their degrees, and the year of their, and when they finished their bachelor's degree. But the year they enter the program, they still enter the same way. They're entering the program. Does that make any sense?
Hopefully, to the person who asked that question, yes, that provided some clarity. So here's another question. Can you comment on the need to align with a specific graduate program? Will the mechanism support transdisciplinary programs that supports training in specific skill sets as an enhancement program for students in other graduate programs to attain additional qualifications.
So I think the answer here is this is a conversation directly with your program officer, or what we can sort of take this as a side conversation. But I think the short answer is we have examples of multidisciplinary training programs, but they really have to have, you know, specific and measurable goals, that there has to be training outcomes that are robust for this training program, that are distinct from the seating department. We certainly don't want to see just piling more requirements on top of existing graduate programs. So it has to be a sort of thoughtful, coherent training program with specific and measurable goals. But we're happy to talk about this more in depth and taking on your particular case.
I don't see any additional ones, so I just thanked everyone, and I said, please keep them coming. There's a few more that folks may have.
So we have a few more minutes left, and then, so if you have any other question, please put that in your chat box. And then just in case you come up with a question later on after the webinar is over, feel free to shoot me an email, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can.
I have two additional ones.
Good.
Can you provide specific examples for how to meet the reproducibility requirements?
So what we did is we've given you some examples of resources, and we've emphasized that your peers were given awards to develop training modules or to develop different training activities around rigor and reproducibility. So these are some examples, and they're provided on the PowerPoint presentation. But I think that one of the things you should think about is that you don't want to necessarily parrot something that somebody else has done. What you want to do is you think hard about your training program and what rigor and transparency means in your particular field. And that's going to be different depending on the discipline. So there are aspects of it that are kind of shared and universal, and that's true. But then there are key pieces that make a particular training program relevant to the science that's being conducted by these individuals. So don't necessarily just look to find something that you can, slot in. I think it really has to be, as we said, it's got to be threaded throughout the entire training program because it's integral to excellence in training. But if you're curious about some of the creative things your colleagues have done, we point you to some resources on the webpage.
So let me just amplify that, because that goes back to what I was saying at the beginning, which is everything that's happening in your training program at some level should be focused on creating rigorous and scientists who do rigorous and reproducible research. So if you're just thinking, we want to add something to our curriculum to check that box, you're going down very much the wrong path. As Allison said, you need to be making sure that throughout the entire curriculum, everything that's happening, throughout the mentored research, everything that's happening is getting to this point of making scientists who are doing rigorous and reproducible research.
Ready for another question?
Yep.
Okay. Can a pre-doc T32 support an MD-PhD student on its grant when an MD-PhD student is conducting its PhD research in that training program?
So, Alison Cole, only accept molecular medicine?
Yeah, that's molecular medicine program is, I think, the only exception to that. Other ones, that is allowable. If you think about the goal of the molecular medicine program, it's to provide medical clinical experience for PhD students, and obviously medical students already get that, so they're not allowed on. That's the only program, though, where that happens.
Is it better to follow the application structure in the PA and slides rather than those on the SF-424 forms?
So that's, well, I mean, that's a good point. So what we tried to do is we didn't want to have redundancy between the FOA and then the application form. So look very carefully at the beginning of each section, and it will say either follow it directly, and then you must go to that document, and you follow that to the law. Sometimes you'll see follow with the following exceptions, and then you follow the FOA, and the FOA always supersedes the instructions in the form. So we didn't want to, you know, reiterate everything that they said in those forms, so we pointed you there for that specific part. But then if it says that, you go with what it says in the FOA. And I'll give you an example of that, which is the bio sketches. That is where the FOA supersedes, and we say you need to have a personal statement to discuss your mentoring, your commitment to mentoring. So that's one obvious example.
So start with the FOA. That's what you want to start
with. Start with the FOA, yeah.
You need that whole thing, and then it'll tell you when you got to go to the other four.
Right.
Someone out in the community wants to thank you all for a great presentation. And, yes, the slides and the video is going to be made available on our website. If you haven't signed up for our NIGMS feedback loop, please do so, because that's sometimes where we actually always let you know what has been posted on our website. I don't see any additional questions.
Anything program staff would like to add that we haven't covered? Lisa? Well, then, in that case, I want to thank everyone, especially John and Allison, Stephanie, Mercedes, and everyone here. So thank you very much, and look forward to working with you. Hopefully, if you have a question, you would not hesitate sending that by email to us. Thank you, and
good luck.
See you. Good luck. Yeah.
Good luck.
See you at the TWD meeting.